In this video, we're going to be taking a look at one of my all-time favorite drum kits from one of my earliest and biggest drumming inspirations, and that is Roger Taylor from Queen and his Silver Sparkle drum kit from the tour of the band's 8th studio album, The Game. This kit was immortalized in the concert film Queen Rock Montreal, and I grew up watching this performance endlessly. It remains one of my favorite concert films to this day, and much of that praise can be directed towards the impact left on my younger self after seeing Taylor perform behind this kit. This was the very beginning of the 1980s, the decade where you wanted your drums to make a statement through appearance alone. In my opinion, this Silver Sparkle drum kit is the peak of his setups, and it showcased much of what would come to define 80s drum kits, specifically with the power toms and inclusion of electronics. I will be going into every detail I possibly can regarding Roger Taylor's equipment used on this tour, with a strong emphasis on what is seen in the Montreal footage. I hope to make this the most accurate description of everything he used during this period of Queen's career. Everything from drums to cymbals to hardware to microphones. Basically anything I could find both in print and online. There are some web pages that run down Taylor's equipment from various points in Queen's history, but there are some contradictions between them, or they just present blatantly wrong information. I mainly used my own eyes to confirm what Taylor was actually using, along with what I could find within the book titled The Drums of Roger Meadows Taylor by Dario Blues DiNardo. I don't own a copy of that book personally, but I was able to find a video that showcases a significant chunk of that book by James Rundle on YouTube. That's it for the introduction. Now, let's take a look at the kit. For a quick history of Taylor's drum sets before 1980, his kits with Queen in the 70s were almost all solid black, with the exception of the natural finish kit used on the tour for A Night at the Opera in 1975, and famously seen in the music video for Bohemian Rhapsody. Speaking of that tour and its associated album, you can definitely see how all the fame and revenue generated from Queen's fourth album filtered into their stage set after its release. Elaborate lighting rigs and stage sets were the obvious new additions, but another notable change was the size of Taylor's drum kits. Through his newly signed deal with Ludwig, he acquired a massive 12-piece kit in their black Cortex finish for the A Day at the Races tour, a huge upgrade from his previous 6-piece setup. However, despite nearly doubling the amount of drums in his arsenal for this tour, Taylor would gradually downsize his kit for the remainder of the 70s, until settling upon a 7-piece setup of Ludwig drums with the addition of 2 Rototoms. The drum set Taylor used during the tour for the Game album was a Ludwig classic in the Sparkle Silver finish, otherwise known as number 104. This is certainly an eye-catching drum set, especially when you consider that the previous kits he had played were almost all plain black in color. Not to say those kits weren't sights to behold themselves, but there's something special about sparkle finishes on drum kits to me, mostly because my first real kit had a sparkle finish as well. The Ludwig Classic drums of this era had 6-ply maple shells and sported the iconic blue olive parallelogram badges. The sizes of the drums are as follows. Taylor played a massive 26x17-inch bass drum, which was a custom size that Ludwig did not offer commercially at the time. It also had a reinforcement tube on the inside to support the immense amount of weight by the mounted toms right above it. The snare drum was a custom 14x7-inch rock concert model in the same silver sparkle finish with 10 lugs and Ludwig's P85 strainer. Taylor also had spare 14x6 and 14x6.5-inch snares, but he mostly used the 7-inch deep one from what I am able to gather. He would actually go on to use these same snares with his chrome finish drum setups over the next few years. And this was for good reason, since they sound absolutely amazing on every recording I've heard of them. The smallest tom on his kit was a 12x8-inch Ludwig Octoplus Melodic Tom, otherwise known as a concert tom, or a tom with no bottom head. Interestingly, the original drum in this position was a chrome Yamaha Stage Custom tom with its bottom head and rim removed. However, this was replaced by the Ludwig drum on the 14th of August 1980 for a performance in Greensboro, North Carolina, which was around a month and a half into the tour for the Game. Quick little fun fact, Roger would actually go on to use a kit consisting of entirely Yamaha drums for Queen's Magic Tour, which would prove to be their final tour with frontman Freddie Mercury. The other two rack toms are both double-headed and measure 13 by 12 inches and 14 by 14 inches. These were actually converted into concert toms at some point during the tour, as seen by the large holes cut in the resonant heads of both drums at the Montreal shows, while photos from much earlier in the tour show them as fully double-headed and mic'd from the top. The floor toms are 16 by 16 and 18 by 16 inches, and they're pretty big drums, but not at all when compared to the 20-inch diameter floor toms that Taylor played before this kit. Just above his floor toms are two Remo Rototoms, measuring 14 inches and 16 inches, which he began using around 1977. Rototoms are single-headed drums you can tune by just rotating the frame on which the drum head rests, and they produce a distinctive and loud bite that many 80s artists would adopt into their setups.
This is mainly a Ludwig drum kit here, with these other things, from the 70s, which are sort of Rototoms. They're tunable like this.
Finally, he had two Ludwig Ringer timpani drums separate from his main kit, which would be used during his thunderous drum solo on this tour. These drums had a copper finish and were 28 and 30 inches in diameter. All of these drums, I think, sound absolutely amazing, and seeing this performance in IMAX with enhanced sound just a few weeks ago was a real treat. As far as I can tell, Taylor never officially endorsed any one specific cymbal company until the Magic Tour in 1986, during which he played exclusively Zildjian cymbals. There does exist an entry for Taylor in the Paiste Profiles publications, which detailed the setups of many Paiste endorsers. This shows that he at one point had a setup of entirely Paiste cymbals around 1981, but my research shows he was still using a mix of cymbal brands around this time, so this may have been a short-lived partnership. The cymbals used for the game tour are a mix of Zildjian, Paiste, and Wuhan cymbals. It's hard to identify the exact model of some of his cymbals just at a glance, since in many shots their labels are obscured by the lighting, or faded to the point of being completely invisible. However, when watching Queen Rock Montreal in IMAX, I noticed some very interesting details I'd never known about or noticed before. I could see some hollow logos on the bottom of his cymbals that said Zildjian and Paiste, and the crash, which I thought was a regular Paiste crash, was actually a 2002 medium, as indicated by the black label on the cymbal. This model is slightly thicker than a standard 2002 crash, and this cymbal in particular was one of their black label 2002s, which were produced in the 70s and later adopted a red label during the transition to the 80s. Paiste 2002s are iconic cymbals, famously used by drummers such as John Bonham and Alex Van Halen. From my research, here's what his cymbal setup on this tour most likely consisted of up to the final shows. Taylor favored the 15-inch Zildjian Newbeat hi-hats throughout his career, and this tour was no exception. The crash to his far left was an 18-inch Zildjian Avidus medium. The crash just left of the center of the kit from his view was the aforementioned 18-inch Paiste 2002 black label medium. But I'm not sure of the exact identity of the crash to his right. The bell is much larger than the confirmed 2002 crash, and the lathing and profile are more reminiscent of the Avidus Zildjian cymbals of the time than any Paiste cymbals I've ever seen. My guess is that the right side crash seen in these shows was another 18-inch Zildjian Avidus medium. His ride was a 20-inch Zildjian Avidus medium ride, another favorite of his during the first decade or so of Queen. Rounding off his kit were the China and Splash cymbals. From Taylor's view, the China on the left was a 22-inch Wuhan China, and the one on his right was a 22-inch Zildjian Swish without the typically included rivets. Wuhan China cymbals are known for their very cheap price points and for producing a very distinct trashy sound that many drummers have found appealing. Just above the hi-hats and on the same stand as the 12-inch tom sat a 10-inch Paiste 2002 Splash. Taylor also had a rack of various splashes and cup chimes by Paiste, mostly consisting of 6 to 8-inch chimes. While this seems like a lot of cymbals to most people, the kit still wasn't complete without the massive 60-inch Paiste symphonic gong, famously bashed at the very end of Bohemian Rhapsody. Taylor was apparently known for the largeness of his gong, if his words are anything to go by.
Known for the hugeness of my gong.
Lastly, there was another 18-inch Zildjian crash mounted above his timpani setup. I couldn't make out the exact model, but I'm going to assume it was another 18-inch Avidus medium crash, like the ones on his main kit. Cymbals can be tricky to identify, so if someone with a better eye for such details is watching this, please don't hesitate to send me a message or post a comment with your guesses as to what cymbals were used during this period of Queen performances. Taylor's drumheads during this time were Ludwig rockers, all with white coatings and various thicknesses. There aren't any clear images showing which thickness of drumheads were used on each drum, but from looking at high-definition stills and clips from the Montreal shows, my eyes see that Taylor used a medium-coated rocker head on the 12-inch concert tom, and likely heavy-coated heads on the rest of the kit. He may have used medium heads on the rototoms and bass drum too. To me that would just make sense, but I can't find anything definitively proving this. I'm also not sure which heads were used on the bottom of each drum, but if I had to guess, they were most likely medium-coated rocker heads, considering most drummers' resonant heads are thinner than their batter side heads. Possibly the most iconic aspect of this kit is the close-up image of Taylor's face on his massive bass drum, which was printed on another Ludwig rocker drum head. In addition to his rototoms and timpani drums, Taylor also played a 9-inch Ludwig timbale cowbell with this kit. It can best be heard during the intro of the song Keep Yourself Alive. Keeping up with the newest developments in the drumming world, Taylor began using Pollard Syndrome pads during the tour for News of the World. By the time of the tour for the game, he was using four of these 8-inch electronic drum pads, which were hooked up to the Syndrome Quad 478 brain. These were very primitive synthetic drum trigger pads, which are often overshadowed by the introduction of the hugely popular Simmons electronic drums, specifically the SDS-5 in the 80s. Taylor would actually adopt these Simmons drums himself for the band's next tour, which was in support of their album Hot Space. I can't say I know exactly when he would use the Syndrums in the set. I've seen the Montreal concert film so many times, but I can't remember him hitting these or hearing what sounds they trigger. If there's something I'm really obviously missing, please let me know. Taylor used Premier 550cc Hickory drumsticks with a custom red and black text during this tour. If it wasn't already clear, a lot of hardware was used to make this drum kit a reality, with most of it coming from Ludwig and Rogers. That being Rogers, the drum making company, not affiliated with Roger Taylor himself. The tom holder mounted on top of the bass drum was a Ludwig 7812 bass drum tom holder, a very flimsy looking mount by today's standards. Taylor's pedal of choice during this period was the Ludwig Speed King bass drum pedal with a hard felt square beater, which Taylor often used. The shaft for the beater actually had to be bent slightly in order for the large felt cube to hit the drum head at the right angle. His hi-hat stand was the Rogers Big R Supreme hi-hat stand with a dual-matic hi-hat clutch. The snare was supported by a Ludwig Atlas or Hercules snare stand, and almost all of the cymbals were supported by Ludwig Hercules boom cymbal stands. These stands look very heavy duty for the time, and even today look like they could take a serious beating on the road. Zildjian cymbal snaps were used on all the cymbals except for the China and the Swish. The cowbell was held up by a Ludwig cowbell holder, and the concert tom was mounted using a Rogers member lock dual tom-tom stand with extension tube. A Roger cymbal arm was mounted on the member lock stand for the splash cymbal as well. Finally, there was a Ludwig Atlas sturdy chrome stand with a 7-pin splash bar off to Taylor's left, which held the various splashes and chimes I talked about earlier. To conclude this deep dive into my personal favorite of Roger Taylor's drum kits, let's have a look at the microphones he used to make this kit be heard loud and clear. It looks as though two Beyer Dynamic M500 microphones were used to mic the bass drum, with one capturing the resonant head, and one capturing more of the batter head through a tiny hole cut in the resonant head. These were single ribbon microphones with hypercardioid polar patterns, an interesting choice for being the only microphones visibly miking the bass drum. But that's just the former audio engineering student in me talking. The snare was mic'd with an AKG C451E on the top, which was a cardioid condenser mic. This mic also featured an A51 swivel elbow by AKG, which helped in positioning the mic's capsule in the optimal location. Two of this same microphone and swivel joint were used as the first pair of overheads on the kit, along with a pair of AKG C414 condenser mics as even higher overheads. The five main toms were mic'd with Sennheiser MD421 cardiodynamic microphones, a very common choice for drummers of this era and even to this day. The double-headed rack toms were originally mic'd from the top, but as stated before, it appears as though they were converted into concert toms at an unknown point during this tour, and the mics were placed inside of them afterwards. The Rototoms were captured by two Shure SM57s, a very common cardioid dynamic microphone. These mics were also sometimes used on the kit's regular toms. The last two mics on the kit are both Shure SM81s. These cardioid condenser mics were used on the hi-hat and side of the snare drum. I couldn't find the exact model of microphone he used for his vocals during this tour, but I found a source which claims he was using the AKG C535EB on the following tour for Hot Space. This cardioid condenser mic may have been the one seen in Queen Rock Montreal, but I'm not fully convinced. If someone has any more information on what this microphone could possibly be, please let me know. Please send me a message, a comment, anything would help. The last set of microphones used on this tour can be found on his timpani setup. Two Sennheiser MD441s can be seen miking each of his Ludwig ringers, which are super cardioid dynamic microphones. Thank you so much for watching. Again, please let me know if I missed anything or if there's any information I got incorrect. Also, feel free to suggest other drummers' kits for me to take a look at for potential future videos. I really enjoyed making this video, and I hope you enjoyed watching it, so I would love to make more of these types of videos in the future.